It is just a huge honor today to be podcast interviewing Eric Schiffman, who's at the ADA convention in Denver right now. Is that correct?
That's correct.
All right. Eric is a professor in the division of TMD and Orofacial Pain at the University of Minnesota. He has received over $14 million in research funding from the National Institute of Health and has over 50 publications. He has lectured locally, nationally, and internationally on topics pertaining to the prevalence, etiology, diagnosis, and management of patients with TMD. Past research includes developing and publishing revised validated diagnostic criteria for temporomandibular disorders for the most common TMD for use in both the clinical and research settings. Past research in TMD management includes assessing the long-term effectiveness in symptomatic closed lock patients of self-care compared to comprehensive rehabilitation with and without TMJ surgery. His recent research assessed the longitudinal impact of TMJ intra-articular disorders on jaw pain, function, and disability. He is currently the principal investigator in a national dental practice-based research network study that is assessing the management of TMD patients by dentists in their practices. He is the inventor and co-owner of the Restful Jaw Company, maker of the Restful Jaw device, which you can find at restfuljaw.com, used to support the jaw during dental treatments. Finally, he is a co-owner of the Interdisciplinary Minnesota Head and Neck Pain Clinic, where he manages TMD and orofacial pain patients. Man, thank you so much for being on my show. You're just a legend in what I consider the most controversial part of dentistry. I mean, seriously, Eric, if I interviewed 10 endodontists who practiced 25 years, they probably wouldn't really argue about almost anything. They almost agree on everything. Orthodontics, I mean, I own Orthotown. Those guys don't disagree about hardly anything. But TMD, it's like world religions. It's like Hindus versus Buddhists, my Catholic sister nuns. I mean, do you agree that TMD is the most controversial, debatable aspect in all of dentistry?
Well, I would agree that it is probably the most controversial, but I would say that over the years, it's gotten less. When I first started 30 years ago, the treatment of TMD was a Ramford and Ash philosophy of get the bite right and they will be fine. And over the years, that hasn't actually, you know, the occlusion was what kind of started all this. And in fact, my first patient that I ever treated was in dental school. He was a farmer, and he came to me and he was clenching his teeth and had some jaw pain. And the prosthodontist that was overseeing me at the time said, grind on his teeth and get it right. And I ground on his teeth and he came back and wasn't any better. And the prosthodontist turned to me and said, grind on his teeth. And so I sat down, and as I was picking out my drill, the guy grabbed my hand and he said, you're grinding on my teeth because I'm grinding on my teeth? It don't make sense, so explain it to me. And from there.
I love it.
So from there, we moved on. And actually what I ended up doing was going to the University of Minnesota. And I was the first resident in the TMD program. Jim Frickton was running it at that time. And I said, why don't you start a residency and make me your first? And that's where I got introduced to controversies. I mean, I was taught by a prosthodontist one day where at that time we were repositioning the jaw to recapture the disc and then finishing up in phase two with getting their teeth together. And on the other day with Jim Frickton, I was doing a multidisciplinary approach with physical therapists and health psychologists. And what I realized is they were the same patients and we were treating them two different ways. And so over the years, I've been doing research trying to figure out what is probably the best avenue. And at this point in time, I think that we've all kind of come down, not all, but we've come to a realization that a lot of these patients with some tender loving care and some self-care, that was one of my studies, can do well. But there is a small percent that probably need more care. But to get back to your question, is it still controversial? Yes.
Now, if you're wondering why Eric seems so gosh darn giddy and happy, it's because his Vikings are 5-0 in a brand new billion-dollar stadium. Was that how much did your tax dollars pay for that? But no, you know, these podcasters are young. You know, older guys like us read books. Millennials are the ones digesting all these podcasts. They're probably too young to remember when we were their age. Remember when who was that guy at Louisiana who was putting in artificial joints?
Kent.
at Kent, yeah. And then they were disintegrating, and they were finding pieces of it in their all over their body and macrophages in it. And I remember in school, people with severe TMJ would be sent to these guys, oral surgeons that everybody would call them butchers, and they'd clip their condyles.
Well, you know, actually, you're right. I go way back too. I go back to when occlusion was everything, or if you went to the oral surgeon, if you got a positive. I mean, I remember one surgeon once said to me, I said, "What's the indication for TMJ surgery?" Breathing positive MRI, and the patient says, "Ouch." Okay, so yeah, you're right. Back then, the whole focus was get the disc in its right position and life will be wonderful. And those were unmitigated disaster. In fact, I was at a conference many years ago, I think it was 1988 or something like that, at the ADA. And someone from, I think it was Aetna, got up and said, "Why is the biggest indication for TMJ surgery prior TMJ surgery?" I mean, it was
Right.
a wild time.
Is Kent is
And
does Kent still practice?
I don't know. I don't know.
Yeah, that was LSU, right?
Yeah, that was
Yeah,
LSU.
so we've seen some that was back in the days of subperiosteals, ramus frames. I mean, that was God, we've seen a lot of changes in 30 years, haven't we?
It certainly has been an interesting journey.
Okay, I want to start with my first question to you is you have guys like Peter Dawson, who's a legend in this area, who says that
Yep.
there's no brain components to it. It's all occlusion. And then you had
Right.
other people saying there's a lot of psychological issues involved. Where do you fit on that continuum?
Well, my belief in occlusion is that it's incredibly important in the vast minority of patients. Okay?
It's
All right. So
incredibly
here's
important in the vast minority of cases.
right. And I think you don't want to miss it, but in many, many cases, that's not the case. In fact, the time that I see it, unfortunately, is after they've had a lot of dental work, is sometimes the case. Now, there, even you can't say it's
Which
necessarily the
led to
occlusion.
your invention, the Restful Jaw device,
Right. Well, you see,
restfuljaw.com.
if you have a long dental procedure, that may be what actually causes the TMD. And in fact, that's why I made the Restful Jaw device. It's a device that the patient wears, and it supports the jaw with a pillow, if you will, or a memory foam underneath the chin, so that when you put a downward force on the jaw, they can just relax into their pillow, or as one person called it, their couch. And so this device is nice in that if you're going to do long dental procedures, especially if the patient has some TMD, we've already shown that that TMD patients have a less pain and fatigue after wearing this. But it only makes sense. If you're pushing down on the jaw, they have to tense their jaw muscles to counteract that force you're putting down. And so that's why I made the device. It was actually a patient that said to me, "I have to hold my hand under my chin, or the doctor does, in order for me to not have pain afterwards." So, and I don't know. I mean, I don't know if the audience knows, but there's a nice study that just came out that said that 23% of all TMD that starts around the mean age of 18 is caused by wisdom teeth extractions.
Right.
And so what we got out there is a situation that if you do a long procedure and the patient has problems afterwards, if you think it's the occlusion and you keep treating them and treating them, and it's because their jaw is sore from having their mouth open, you're down a really bad rabbit hole.
Right. Yeah, and the problem with that wisdom teeth also is, I mean, I talk to young kids and they'll spend an hour and a half on one impacted tooth. I mean, I'm 54. I'll pull all four of them out in under 10 minutes every single time. And I mean, could you imagine having your jaw open for an hour and a half while someone's trying to take out a wisdom tooth?
Yeah, I watch it at the U. Yeah,
Yeah.
well, you know, you got a good point. But I will say that even in 10 minutes, I've watched people do things that the surgeons that are working really fast. The problem is if you don't know, if you're having somebody support the jaw, your assistant, while you're taking out those wisdom teeth, the assistant doesn't always know the direction of force you're going to put. And some patients, even a little force is too much force.
And by the way, I want to tell my homies that there's no money exchange on these podcasts. I called Eric Schiffman. He's a legend in this. He did not call me. There's no, this isn't an advertisement or anything like that. So, okay. So again, let's focus on, we probably got an audience under 30. We probably got an audience that's 20% junior and senior in dental school and the other 80%. I get like one email a month says, "Hey dude, I'm an old guy like you, love your show," but it's mostly kids. They all just grad, you know, 6,000 of them just graduated. They know what they know. They don't know what they don't know. What do you think, they should, don't know about TMD, and how should they continue their journey to learn more about TMD?
I would say that the thing about TMD, what they typically get taught in dental school, there was a survey done by Chuck Green many years ago, and they're, because it's not a specialty, dental schools don't have to spend a lot of time or resources on this. Even at the university where I'm at, I only get one semester class to teach them with optional rotations through our clinic. And even I do an optional exam where I have my faculty come in. We pair up with the students and teach them. How many students you think actually come to the class to learn how to, it's optional to learn how to do a simple TMD exam?
10.
Oh, no. Actually, I feel better. We finally hit 66%. Okay.
Nice. 2/3. Nice.
Yeah. I mean, and that's optional. We do it at 5:30 after class because we don't have the time. But getting back to your question, what is it that they know? I think what they know is that TMD is an area where there's a lot of physical treatments done out there. It's called the biomedical model. You go in, you fix the discs. You go in, you fix the occlusion. You go in and do these things. And in some individuals, that is indicated, but not in the vast majority. I'd say a lot of these patients, I mean, what's the typical patient? Patient comes in. Female patient, that's the typical patient, comes in stressed out, probably has anxiety and depressions, and they're going through a life situation, maybe a divorce or something, and life is tough and they're clenching the heck out of their teeth. You know, tell me grinding on their teeth is going to do it. Tell me putting their disc that's been popping for 30 years and never been a problem, tell me that's the problem. So in those individuals, that's why I like to approach it in my private practice and at the university. I'm fortunate to have a team, and on that team is typically a physical therapist, because it is a muscle skeletal problem. You treat it like any other muscle skeletal problem. And two, I have a psychologist, because there are significant behavioral problems beyond just oral habits, putting on pens, pencils, fingernails, all that stuff. But there's also a whole component of what is their psychosocial situation, you know? And I think that trying to teach, to treat, what I do when I teach is how to triage these patients. We call them simple, intermediate, and complex. The simple patient, some good self-care, maybe using a mouth guard or a splint and some self-care, occasionally some short-term medication. That's called medical management. And they should treat it the same as a physician when you go in with back pain. Educate the patient, give them time to heal, and send them home with some self-care. Use a heat and ice, keep the tongue up, teeth apart, other things like that. But then the intermediate.
What pharmacology on the first one?
Pharmacology, well, the typical one, we did a nice study at the U. Corey Herman, one of our residents a few years ago and now my business partner, he did a really nice study where he took self-care. So that's some stuff they can do at home. Again, the heat, the ice, keeping their tongue up, et cetera, and not clenching. And we compared it. We gave them a placebo. We gave them self-care and clonazepam. It used to be called Flexrel, nice muscle relaxant. And then we gave them self-care and clonazepam. It's like Valium, benzodiazepine. What do you think happened? Well, 40% of the people with self-care and placebo with jaw pain had a 40% reduction in pain within 3 weeks. You add the clonazepam, it's 70%. I mean, I'm sorry, the cyclobenzaprine, the Flexrel, it's 70% reduction in the intensity of pain in 3 weeks. You add the clonazepam, it's 40%. It didn't do anything. It was surprise. But nonetheless, that suggests, and I use, if I use it, I will use Flexrel. When I have patients that come in with their jaw lock closed with a lot of pain, I will use a Medrol dose pack short term with self-care and then get them going with some physical therapy and some other things. But I don't use opioids. So the medications typically, well, you can use over-the-counter NSAIDs or even acetaminophen short term, or you can prescribe those. If you prescribe them, especially the ibuprofen, you'll get a much better robust effect. It's called the placebo effect or the nonspecific effect. And frankly, everything we do in the world of pain is about 30 to 60% placebo anyway. And so, yeah, and if people say that, is that bad? I say that's good because you should maximize that. Because what you're really trying to do in this whole show is maximize the ability of the patient to manage their problem and self-heal.
Nice. Well said. You know, and I want to take these kids back on a journey back probably when they weren't born, but the orthopedic surgeon, the MDs, want to rule the world, and they tried to shun chiropractors, and the government started covering chiropractors for lower back pain. And the Congress's rationale was that if I send you to an orthopedic surgeon, they're going to bill $50,000 and fuse three spine. If I send you to a chiropractor, you're going to bill $500, and we're going to get the same outcome. Do you remember that? Remember those debates? So you know, the orthopedic surgeons, they wanted that 50 grand. They'd cure everything by fusing three discs together. And here you're saying that pain is 60% in the head. It's you know, 30 to 60% treatment is placebo, right?
Well, you know, I said that, but let me say this. Placebo has got a really bad name out there. It's like it's something not good. But what it really is, why do you think that faith healers and all those things work? It's because the patient believes. And as soon as they believe, they get hope. And as soon as they get hope, their ability to heal is maximized. So I want to say to your audience, you know, we are healers when we're treating pain. And it isn't that we have the power to heal the patient. We have the power to maximize the patient's ability to heal itself. If you want to call that mind, I call it mind-body.
So I want to tell our viewers that, you know, to try to get $14 million from the National Institute of Health, I mean, the only other person I know who has done that was a tooth fairy, and she rode in there on a unicorn and shot up half the room. So you have to have so much credibility before the NIH would hand you $14 million. But why do you think in dentistry, the god of this, the guru, the legend, Pete Dawson, thinks it's all occlusion? And those guys, those Dawson guys driving to work right now on their hour commute, when you said that, you know, it's very important, almost never, they almost drove off the road and are probably on their way to hunt down Eric Schiffman.
Yep.
So how could there be this huge, I mean, I don't believe a 1 hour podcast is going to change your mind. I'm not stupid. I couldn't give my oldest sister, Sister Anne of Yahweh, a 1 hour lecture and have her switch from a Catholic nun to a Buddhist. I mean, you know, it's not going to happen. I mean, it's the nature of sapien. They don't change their minds. You know, they always think they're open-minded and they're so closed-minded. But what would you say to that dentist? He's never going to believe you anyway, Eric. He's going to say, Peter Dawson sits at the right hand of Jesus. What would you say to that guy? I mean, how could you guys be so far apart?
Okay, well, here's the deal. What Dawson has is an immense amount of clinical experience, okay? And what if you do something and the patient gets better and you assume that it's what you did, then I understand where they're coming from. But a lot of these people can get better even on their own or despite what we do, okay? They go in remission. I mean, that's why you give them a little time. But let me just say this. I had clinical experience way back even when I was a resident 30 years ago. Like I said, one day we treated them from a prosthodontist perspective at that time. Not now, but at that time. And we treated them the other one from a mind-body treatment, really. And so I got to see. And what I realized is on the one day I was doing it, and this one treatment and the other on the other, they were the same patients. You know, and so it was like, wow, this is like an experiment. And what I found over time was actually the prosthodontist that trained me when I became head of the division came to me one day and said to me, I'm done. I don't want to do this anymore. When I got into this, I thought it was a mechanical problem, and I'm good at that. But these patients that we get anymore, they're just complex. And I said, you know what, John? They're the same patients we've been treating all along. It's just your view has changed. And so You know what I found was, at the beginning, I adjusted everybody's bite afterwards, because that's what we did on that day after treatment, or we did prosthodontics. We got, don't get me wrong, if you got missing teeth and all that, do it for a dental reason. There's plenty of them. But nonetheless, what I found was, as I did less and less irreversible treatments, the treatment didn't seem to come out different. But I will give this in the counter argument to me is this. Eric, there's no good evidence out there. And in fact, if you look at the Cochrane reviews, which is all the clinical trials out there that have looked at occlusion, there's about six of them that are actually pretty darn good randomized clinical trials. The bottom line is, the question on occlusion has actually, in my opinion, never been definitively studied. And the problem, so the answer really is, we have a lack of evidence of whether or not occlusion is important, not proof that it isn't. And it ain't going to happen because NIH isn't going to fund it, because the reviewers that review these believe that the answer is already done. So in summary, in defense, the people that believe in occlusion, I think that they have seen results, but I think they were on uncontrolled conditions. My clinical experience says I can get away. I don't always have to do more. The research, we don't have a definitive answer, and I'd love to go and do a study with the gurus in the area and see, compared to the other treatment, just do a nice study and kind of answer this question instead of us all going about it like a religion.
Yeah, I tell you, Dennis, there's nothing that pisses off a dentist more than a fact that doesn't agree with his religion.
Well, you know the saying, although truth is rare, the supply is way outweighs the demand.
Hey, so what percent of TMD is women versus men?
Okay, well, if you look at, there's a nice study done out in North Carolina by Bill Maxner. By the way, he got more money than me. I'm second. Anyway,
hey, Ryan, we're going to have to delete this podcast and call him.
Great guy.
Introduce us. Maybe we should do introduce us, email him, and then CC me, Howard@dentaltown.com. I'd love to meet the person who got more money than you.
Oh, he would love to talk. He's a great guy. He's done a nice study, just really, really brief. He's the one that's done the first etiology study on this, okay? What they did was they took people with no TMD and followed them over time, and those that developed TMD, they compared to those that didn't. And actually what they found out was oral habits were a big deal. People that do oral habits are at a bigger risk of developing this. You're not just clenching their teeth, but chewing gum, biting on pens, pencils, fingernails, lips, cheeks, all that good stuff. But he also found that one of the best predictors actually turned out to be if the patient has a lot of pain throughout their body, they're more apt to develop pain in their jaw. And that kind of makes sense. When I see a patient that comes in that has total body pain, like fibromyalgia, I just tell them you can get fibromyalgia, which is a muscle pain disorder. They have pain throughout their body. I just tell them, you know what? You got fibromyalgia in your jaw muscles. And actually, that's a true statement. So, yeah, he's done a very, very nice study out there.
What's his name?
Bill Maxner.
M-A-X-N-E-R?
Put an I in there. M-A-I-X-N-E-R. Bill. Good guy.
Huh. So back to women. Is it 80% women?
In our clinics. The reason why that came up is it turns out that it's pretty close in the general population.
So you're saying Bill Maxner said it was about 50-50 men, women?
A lot of people have said it's about 60-40. Yeah. In the population. But our clinics definitely are more female.
So the clinics are what, 80-20?
I'd say so.
But the etiology is 60-40?
Yeah, the prevalence in the general population is something like that.
So basically women are just more likely to go to the doctor than men?
That's one of the conclusions, yes.
What are some other conclusions?
Well, you know, there's been some conclusions. Well, the other thing is we see a lot of females in their you know, 18 to 45. And so those are the reproductive years. And so there's been some thoughts about, is that also another factor? And, you know, they've implicated like estrogen, it can make the collagen fibers more lax, and so you can get more laxity in the ligaments and disc displacements. But there's been a number of other things. But it's actually probably due to the fact, if you want my bias, is women go to the doctor more, so they're more apt to be diagnosed too.
Yeah, and there's a ton of research on that. I mean, Regina Hertzlinger is a PhD medical economist, and she was from Harvard, and she was saying that almost over 90% of all appointments are made by women.
Yeah, well, they make appointments for their men. That's the only time they can get their men in.
Yeah, I mean, my son Eric is married. I mean, I don't think there's I'd probably get hit by a meteorite twice before I saw him make his own doctor's appointment. I mean, his wife Janelle would do all that. So how much is this restful jaw?
The restful jaw. How much does it sell for?
Mm-hmm.
$1,995. It is made so that it will last a long, long time. It does have some padding on it, and the chin support are all replaceable. But that's what the cost is.
And how long you been selling this?
I've been selling it for about 2 years.
And how's it going?
It's going slow. One of the things we're finding that was somewhat surprising to me was that a lot of the dentists they don't ask their patients if dental treatments hurt. You know, they just go in and they do their thing. And the issue with that is if you don't know you have a problem with a patient, that can get you into trouble, of course, because they can flare up during that. But that's one of the issues. And the other is a lot of the older dentists tell me, well, you know, I've never needed this, and the patients get better. So, you know, if I hurt their jaw, it's okay. They're going to get better in a few days. And I was kind of surprised that there wasn't a big concern about hurting people.
Interesting. I wonder, you know, a lot, you know, there's, you know, if a high dentist works 40 hours a week, 50 weeks a year, she can only service 1,000 people for a cleaning twice a year. And right. If you get 25 new patients a month, you'd add a new hygienist every 2.5 years. You'd add 4 hygienists every decade. So you'd think after you practice 10, 20, 30, 40 years, and you still need 25 new patients a month, and you still only have 1 hygienist, you'd think you'd realize that your customers are never coming back. And if you could establish that this was, you know, instead of spending 3% on advertising, start spending 3% on patient loyalty stuff, like a painless injection with the wand or the restful jaw. I mean, I can see where if a patient said, oh my God, I really like this and I'm staying here because this is the only dentist that does this, I would position it as a patient loyalty program, because the worst drug in dentistry is advertising. These guys, these guys just, you know, when I got out of school, advertising was taboo. Within 10 years out, they said you should spend 3% on advertising. Now, 30 years out, they're saying 5 to 7% of collections goes to advertising. It's like, dude, there's no patient retention. These guys have not increased their hygiene capacity decade after decade after decade. So some of the things that make them come back, like in my office, they'll say, well, you're the only dentist that I've had that had nitrous oxide or evening hours, or took my insurance. Maybe this restful jaw will go into that patient loyalty deal. And another thing you should do, Eric.
Well, you know, I would add there is that the counter, which is, you know, the other thing that dentists tell me is, I don't have a solution, so I don't want to bring it up. So you have a good point there. Why bring up a problem that you actually don't have a solution to? I think you got a good point with the patient loyalty. The other thing is, there's a nice study that came out of the University of Kentucky down there with Okeson's program, and what they found was 63% of their TMD patients weren't getting regular dental care. Well, the dentist might say, well, I don't really want to treat them, but you know, they come with families. You know, and the other thing that we've gotten with our patients when we have done focus groups is they say, it's just nice that they actually have something and that they show that they care. I mean, that's the patient loyalty piece you're talking about, and I couldn't agree more. If you ask a patient now, hey, do you have jaw problems? Does it hurt after dental work? They're going to be surprised. If they just did it for 1 week, they'd be surprised how many people say yes, and it isn't just females. And if they then went in and said, hey, I have a solution. We've had many people, many TMD patients tell us, it's just nice that they care, that shows that they care, and that there's something they can do. And that's going to be make my device work even better, because again, you're hitting into the non-specific effect stuff. You're giving them hope, and you're dealing with their issue.
And the dentists who always crush it, in my 30-year observation, are the ones that crush it in all the human soft stuff, the empathy, the talking, the listening, the chairside manner. I mean, another great marketing thing you should do is, you know, we got 225,000 dentists on Dental Town, and 50,000 have downloaded the app. And on the app and Dental Town, we put the online CE, where they get ADA, AGD credit. We put up 360 courses. They've been viewed over 600,000 times. You are probably the most qualified guy I know to do an online course on TMD, management of TMD. And then you got to also explain with your course why you came to the conclusions to make your restful jaw device. I think that'd be the best marketing you could do.
That's good advice.
And send in and do an article for Dental Town on it. Send it into you could do a Dental Town article and a online CE course. I think that would, I can't think of any bigger way you could get your message out.
Sounds good.
So let's switch gears to your clinic. You have the Minnesota Head and Neck Pain Clinic. Why didn't you call it the Vikings Pain Clinic?
Because we are really close to Wisconsin.
You didn't want to run off the cheeseheads? So now in this Minnesota Head and Neck Pain Clinic, where you manage TMD and orofacial pain patients, is it like a specialty clinic? It specializes just in TMD?
Well, I got to watch that word because, you know, TMD.
No, you don't. No, you don't. You don't have to watch that word anymore. Did you follow the Texas lawsuit?
I did, but that hasn't changed. I think in February that's going to change with the ADA vote. But at this very moment.
With the ADA vote?
Yeah, there's an eight. Well, they're basically going to say whether or not, you know, are they the only exclusive ones that can give.
No, the bottom here. Here's how the lawyers.
Yeah, you're right. It's over.
It's over. I mean, basically, the placebo effect has been that the American Dental Association and the American Medical Association. I mean, everything we believe is pretty much a myth, and the myth has been that they are the overriding body of dentistry. And right. But when it went to the courts, the judge said, dude, you're a membership club. You're a membership. This is a country club. You're not a regulatory agency. You have zero legislative ability. And then they asked this dentist, they said, well, I mean, are you a specialist in implants? I mean, he goes, yeah, this is all we do. And he's like, okay, so you're telling the truth to the consumer, and what, some membership club says you can't do it? That's baloney. And it is blown. I mean, if all you do is TMD, the consumer comes first. I love Google's motto where, you know, the consumer comes first. And whenever their programmers are arguing about what to do, you know, the two founders would just say, Sarge, Bernie, and Larry Page just say, well, what, you know, how does this work for the consumer? And that's their guiding light. And the guiding light is, if I'm in Minnesota and I got TMJ, I don't care if they call it TMD, TMJ, jaw pain, whatever, they should be able to get on Google and the internet and find someone who just does that. And so the consumer should come first, not the political interest of different specialty parties, you know.
You got that. You're singing to the choir.
Yeah, that's why periodontists and oral surgeons fight over implants. The periodontists are thinking about adding implants to their names. And we need to be customer focused. And every single dentist who tells me they're customer focused, I mean, I'm always amazed they can even say it with a straight face. Like, well, what are your hours? Monday through Thursday, 8 to 4. Okay, just stop. You know, just stop. But anyway, so tell me, so is it a specialty clinic? Where's it at?
We have three clinics in the cities, one in the St. Paul, one in Woodbury, and two suburbs for your listeners.
Minneapolis, St. Paul?
Yeah, Minneapolis, St. Paul.
So you have one in St. Paul, and what are the two other cities?
We have one in Woodbury and then one in Burnsville.
Do you know Woodbury and Burnsville?
I'm sorry, not Woodbury. What am I? Plymouth, and we closed the one in Woodbury. I'm sorry, it's Plymouth and Burnsville.
And Burnsville. Have you heard of Lake Elmo?
Oh, sure.
That's where my oldest sister's Carmelite monastery is.
Really?
Yeah, she's been in. So to go visit her, to make it a business expense, I have to do business for 4 hours and 1 minute. So I fly down to Minneapolis, and I either go to 3M for 4 hours and 1 minute, or I go to Patterson for 4 hours and 1 minute and hang out there. And then at 12:01, then I go spend the rest of the day with my older sister.
Well, you come visit me now.
Okay, can you make it out? Can you give me a note for the IRS? Say
no problem.
We talked about TMJ for 4 hours and 1 minute. And the other reason I wanted to get the names is because a lot of these dentists who did podcasts with me, you know, these are posted on YouTube and iTunes. It exploded their SEO, and a lot of these guys who do dentistry were saying, "God, I've had three different patients from three different states that I've never had a patient before fly to my office after watching my podcast with you on YouTube."
Really?
Yeah. You know, they were implant guys, and they were doing, you know, they were talking about implants, and they said, you know, I'm in a small town. I don't think the guy I go to knows anything about any of this stuff or cosmetics. And they said, Southwest Airlines, only $150. I'm going to fly to the big city and let this be, because it's a huge perceived expert. I mean, it is. I mean, you know, there's 2 million dentists. I'm interviewing you about TMD. So that's why I wanted to get the names of the city, St. Paul, Plymouth, and Burnville. And, but anyway, so, how many doctors are in this? Or do you have hygienists? Do you have recall? Is it just?
No. This is all orofacial pain. What we have is, at our flagship clinic in, St. Paul, is we have, the team for orofacial pain. We have a physical, we have a dentist that's trained in this area. A lot of residents that have gone through our program. We have physical therapists, and we have health psychologists. We also have a neurologist. We have a neurologist that specializes in pain so that we can treat total body pain when they come in with pain throughout their body. We actually have two. One does a lot of mind-body treatment. The other does acupuncture and Botox treatment, depending on what the indications are. And we also have a nurse practitioner that assists with all that. So we actually can treat the whole body from a mind-body perspective. We don't just isolate and treat just their pain in their jaw. We treat the pain, and if it's throughout their whole body and they want to do that, we will help them with the whole show. Because, you know, when somebody has a lot of pain, it's kind of like the Maxner study. We found that clinically, anecdotally, that when they have pain throughout their whole body, it's hard to treat this area. There was a nice study that was done a number of years ago by Marbeck and Karen Raphael. And what they did is they randomized patients to essentially a Holley appliance versus a flat plane splint, and they didn't find any difference. But then what they did was they took everybody out that had widespread pain, and they found that splints are better. And what they showed was that when people have pain throughout their whole body, they don't really respond as well. And it makes sense, because you're kind of trying to put out a big fire with a thimble full of water.
That is amazing. So, you know, I know my homies. I mean, I've been a dentist for 29
Sure.
years. I've lectured 1,000 times. Telling them that you are almost holistic or have acupuncture, I mean, it'd probably be more politically correct to tell them you're a communist. Do you get much pushback from locals?
You know what the bottom line is here? The bottom line is this. You know, when you're treating a patient, probably one of the most important things to know. I mean, I agree. You need to know the physical diagnosis. You need to go through the history and all that. But when I'm washing my hands and getting ready to examine the patient, I ask them what I think is one of the most important questions. What do you think I should do to help you? And I want to know what their belief system is. And if a patient tells me that, you know what, my aunt had 14 splints and I don't think they're going to work, I got to know that. I got to explain either why this might be different or why they might be right. Now, if a patient says to me, you know, I've had acupuncture and it worked really well. Well, acupuncture is kind of like trigger point injections, or, you know, it's the thing that if you go in with back pain, they're injecting you all over the place. And you know what? If you just put in a needle, you can't really usually bill for it medically. So they put a drug in, and all of a sudden it becomes an injection and they can get paid for it. And they've already shown that acupuncture, dry needling, there's no difference. You know, and so the bottom line is, why not go with the patient's belief system? I want to know what they believe. If I think what they believe is wrong, I will try to explain to them why. But if not, I'm going to rock and roll, as you say, with their belief and work in other things if I think it's useful. I mean, there's no reason for me to sit there and tell them to do something that they believe isn't going to ever work.
So I want to throw some things out there and have you run with it. Rant on equilibration.
What's that?
Equilibration.
Equilibration has been assessed in four different studies. Three of them said it's no different than placebo. And one of the placebos is grinding on the sides of the teeth. One study that was funded by the American Equilibration Society, though, showed that if you ground on their teeth before they had TMD, they had less TMD later. That's it. I just summarized the research in the area.
Okay.
Now, and so, again, I'm going to go back to, I'm not, the definition of an expert is knowing the boundary between the known and unknown. That's the bottom line. I don't know everything. I just know where my knowledge limitations are. And again, in this area, I'm not going to say to your audience that I know you, that this doesn't work in a lot of cases or isn't necessary in a lot of cases. What I'm saying to them is it doesn't appear to be, but I don't have the hard evidence on it. But I will say to them is, unless go with what NIH recommendations are. NIH says if you put in a high restoration or there's some other obvious occlusal problem, you can do a selective adjustment, no problem. I'm not telling someone that they need to have holistic treatment because they put in a high crown and don't adjust it. I mean, come on, it makes sense. But to do a full mile, 3-hour equilibration at the beginning of treatment, I don't think is a great idea. And it's for two reasons. One, sometimes your teeth can be sensitive afterwards. And two, you know what? If you do this to the patient, then what happens is they believe that you are healing them and they aren't oftentimes willing to self-manage themselves. So I will add that later in some cases, but I actually haven't done a 3-hour equilibration, 3-appointment, 1-hour equilibration in many, 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 many years.
And, you know, another thing with the science, I mean, you know, I've done hundreds and hundreds of orthodontic cases. I mean, how can you go listen to all the TMD people and then go see what the 10,000 orthodontists are doing and tell me that's not, I mean, the orthodontists are, you know, changing canine guidance to group function. They're altering the curve of speed, the curve of Wilson. They're just changing
yep.
everything.
Right.
And then you go to this, I know that in orthodontics, you could take off the bands or something in one, and you could only be hitting on one tooth.
Right.
And you could just take out the wires and say, come back in a week, and the bite slams it right back down. You know, it just goes right back to place, and it's like...
Well, teeth are joints. They move.
Yeah, it's... okay. So, TMD, what's the link of TMD and orthodontics? Some people treat TMD. I know dentists personally, and people have TMD, they say this. I've stood there in the room watching. They say, you know, every joint in the body, my elbow determines where my hand is. My knee determines where my foot is. But this is the only joint where the teeth come together and the joint's left where it's at. So what you need to do is you need to go through full braces. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to align your bite closing with your joint seating, and that'll be the end of the TMD. I mean, I know guys who do 25 cases of orthodontics a year with that one-liner.
Yep.
So what do you think of that?
I think that if they need orthodontics, they ought to do orthodontics. Okay, but I believe that if you look at the research on this, there is no definitive study on this, unfortunately, either. My belief is that you're absolutely correct. The endpoint in the closed pack position with the joint in its most stable position is with the teeth together. However, let me just say this. There seems to be this belief out there that there is a normal. And I have a little problem with a static. We got to get to this exact point to be normal. Normal is called a range. There's a range of normal. And what we've never seen is that occlusion is predictive of whether people develop TMD or not. And so I think that to tell people that I'm going to do this to treat your TMD is, in many cases, over-treatment. Because with time and some self-care, a lot of these, and education, a lot of these people can do well. And in 2 years, a lot of these people will do well. So if they're going to do well anyway, with or without orthodontics, if you did it, then you're going to say, hey, see, it was my orthodontics.
We've had TMD experts come on this podcast and say that you should, that it is malpractice to do a night guard or an NTI for bruxing without a complete sleep apnea, obstructive sleep apnea test, because that is why they're grinding their teeth. They're having sleep apnea. Thoughts?
I think that the current belief in the area of bruxism is that it can be a sleep disorder or a parasomnia, if you will. Some people walk at night. I had a patient that came in and woke up every morning cooking breakfast. It was handy but a little dangerous. Nonetheless, I think that they're confusing all the different sleep disorders out there, and they're calling them all sleep apnea in this case. I think that there's no question that there's overlap between TMD and sleep problems, and that some people with TMD have sleep apnea. But I don't believe that you have – I think you should ask some basic questions. I don't know if you have to give them the Epworth scale or some similar scale, but you should ask them. And I've actually gotten it down to, you know, snoring and that. But my biggest question really is, do you wake up rested? And if they don't, I'm not as concerned about it, because that's the end point of the treatment anyway. And so I think that some of these people do. What we do in our practice, because we treat sleep too, is we usually treat the TMD first and then deal with the sleep. If they feel good with the forward position, we might go right to the sleep apnea appliance. But you have to remember, those things pull the jaw forward, and you can aggravate some people with no TMD and make them into a TMD patient. So you got to be careful with this whole belief. The problem is kind of like saying, how do you treat TMD? And someone says, this is how you treat every TMD patient. No. There's a whole spectrum of it, depending on what their physical findings are, what their findings are when you look at their occlusion, which I always do. But at the same time, let me throw in with the occlusion. I don't know if there's a lot of people out there that realize that TMD actually causes bowel occlusions. I mean, if you get a bad, it can be transient, you get a fusion in the joint, your teeth don't touch on that side. You get bilateral osteoarthritis or degenerative joint disease in your joints, it can rotate back and you can get an open bite. I see rheumatoid patients, more so years ago when we didn't have the drugs, the young idiopathic, juvenile idiopathic arthritis patients that came in with open bites and their jaws back and no condyles. I mean, so let me just say, you got to figure out what the heck is going on, and you deal with it. I see everything from patients with a lot of mechanical problems to patients with a lot of psychosocial problems. And there isn't one treatment. And going back to your sleep question, it actually isn't believed so much that sleep apnea causes bruxism. That has not been definitively shown. But it is clear that some people have sleep disorders, and those do need to be treated.
Yeah, and the media is having a heyday with the evidence for flossing, too.
Well, that's the problem is, you know, I mean, logically speaking, I mean, I've had so many people ask me about that. And I said, that's another example where we have lack of evidence, but we certainly have a lot of accumulated clinical evidence that this is useful. I mean, what is evidence-based dentistry anyway? It's using the best available evidence with the experience of the clinician and the belief system of the patient mixed together. I mean, that's what it is. And I think it's kind of a shame that we didn't do a nice little study to show that flossing works. And I bet that that's on the high agenda at NIH right now.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's hilarious, even within my, so I have two sisters that went into the nunnery after, straight after high school, right?
Sure.
And they can't even agree on half the kind of stuff. We're in the middle of a heated election. This is the craziest election I've ever seen in my lifetime, but I even think it's what's the craziest is no one's even addressed the obvious, and that is that the fastest growing, most productive economies in the world, Singapore and China, have a hierarchical form of government in all of nature for gorillas, chimpanzees, orangutans, bonobos, all those apes. They're all hierarchical. And then we've decided that we totally believe this myth that democracy is the best. And we're all going to vote every 4 years on the teacher. And then the teacher comes forward and says, well, what is she going to say? We're going to study math. And the other one campaigns, oh, no, you vote for me and you'll go to recess. And then at lunch, one candidate's saying, we're only going to have fruits and vegetables. The other one's saying, we're just going to have ice cream, pizza, and french fries. I mean, I've lived in America 54 years. I don't even believe that myth. I think the only way democracy works is if everybody was really educated and really rational and a really intellectual person. And I look at these third of a billion humans and it's like, I don't know. I think Singapore is a hierarchical model. That's better. I mean, so much of what we believe is myth. I'm going to go back on to some more.
You know what democracy is? It's the tyrant. If you believe what you just said, then you would like this quote. It's the tyranny of the majority.
Yeah. I mean, you go to China and, you know, every one of them in their government is an engineer and everything works. The trains, the planes, you know, you come to the United States and all the leaders are lawyers, just lying for a living. I'm going to go back to another thing that two dentists can't agree on. Abfractions. Oh, my God. There's, you know, some people say, no, look at it. They're sawing back and forth their toothbrush. Then some of the people are saying, look, there's abfractions on antelope and deer, and they don't own a toothbrush. Rant on abfractions.
You know, I don't really rant on a lot of things. I think one of the other factors there, though, if you're talking about missing the enamel on the cervical surfaces, on the buccal surface, essentially, I think one of the other things that we have seen with that one is some people, when they clench, they flex the teeth, and they can pop off the enamel with that as well. I mean, again, you have hit on the right thing. Anybody that tells you that there is one cure for a diagnosis, I would walk away. Because there isn't usually one cause for anything. There might be common things. But for the patient with persistent problems, they probably got something uncommon going on. But as far as abfractions, we can argue about that one all day.
Is there treatment? If it's just abfractions, that's it. Some people fill them in with a fake white tooth composite stuff. Now the periodontists are bringing the pink stuff up. So the periodontists are bringing the pink stuff up to cover them. The dental dentists, their only tool is the plastic stuff. So they're taking white stuff down. Some people say they don't even need a treatment. Well, what are you telling? And you're talking to a lot of kids right now. They're all under 30. So they got a patient in their chair. They just got an associate job at Aspen. And some 40-year-old man comes in and he's got, eight abfractions, 2 or 3 millimeters deep on all of his bicuspids. And he didn't even know he had them.
So he was asymptomatic.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, I think what you do, if you want my opinion, obviously you do, and that is you educate him. You say, hey, you usually either use a mirror like I used to, or if you have your video system, you say, look at these. You have these here. These could have been there for a long, long time. It can be due to a number of things. A common thing is brushing your teeth hard. Another is clenching your teeth. I want you to be aware of that. We can watch this now. And if we have it on the video, we got a picture of it. If this gets worse or it gets symptomatic, we can do something about it. If it bothers you cosmetically because men show lower teeth more, I can do something with this, or a woman, whatever. And so really it comes down again to educating the patient, telling them what's going on, giving them the option of monitoring, and telling them what are possible causes so that they can see if they can stop doing it themselves.
Yeah, and a lot of times the patient, the PPO insurance they have only will cover it if you take him to the vet and put him down. So a lot of times that's
really?
I'm just kidding. Okay, another question. She's 25 years old. She just got a job in Tulsa, Oklahoma, for an associate. Every time someone comes in and they grind and they clench and they have TMD, the doctor makes a night guard, and she's in a group practice, and one dentist uses hard night guards, one swears by soft, and the other one's using NTI, and she's literally set on Dental Town. I mean, I'm working in a practice with three different gods. There's three different religions. They don't even agree. I'm 25. They're all mentors of mine. So what would you say? Hard, soft, NTI in one practice, and she's looking at all three of those. Which one, what should she do?
Okay, there was a nice study that was done in the University of Washington that compared hard and soft splints, and they didn't find a difference, and they followed them over a year. And this was just soft splints, not a, like a Profor. You know what I'm talking about? Mm-hmm. And so I would say that there's another study that was done by Wright, Ed Wright, really good guy, really good book on TMD, very practical.
What's his name?
Ed Wright.
Will you introduce me to those two guys? Will you send an email to Bill Maxson and Ed Wright?
Yeah, Ed Wright, he's a real practical guy. He went through our program, really good guy. He's down in Texas, very smart, wrote an excellent book on this that's perfect for the general practitioner, just perfect. But what I would say is this. I also use it. There's the intermediate, you know, like the Bruxy's splints. I'm not trying to give any particular problem, but the thermoplastic is what I should have said, the thermoplastic ones. I actually, my experience and the research says, you know, any of those work. But the one principle I'd go on here is this, make it full coverage.
So okay? You don't like the NTI then?
The reason why the NTI has actually had three nice studies comparing it to flat plane splints, nice randomized clinical trials. And what they have shown is that they have about the same outcome, but there's more occlusal changes with the NTI, which is no surprise. You put in, I mean, years ago, there used to be the Gelp appliance. I'm so old. Harold Gelp came out with it. And what it is, it was an appliance where they just covered the back teeth. And that acrylic was attached by this little lingual metal bar, okay? So nothing over the front teeth. So, and what would these patients, a lot of them didn't have major occlusal changes, but the ones that were clenching like mad, they would come in and have bilateral posterior open bites, or they'd have four new crowns already to treat their bilateral posterior open bites. And so, you know, anytime you're doing a partial coverage splint, whether it's just covers the back teeth, just covers the front teeth, you have a potential for changes. We see people coming in on the NTIs where they got a space between their front teeth and they don't like it because it makes their S's sound funny. I mean, I wouldn't do that to people. And finally, I will say the partial coverage ones that just clip to the canine to canine or just over the incisors, there's a couple cases where they were aspirated as well. In fact, what I tell people is if you're going to use the NTI, why don't you drill a hole in it, put a floss around in it, put it around the patient's neck so that if they swallow it, you can pull it back, you know? And so if it can, if an NTI has the same outcome, or an NTI-like splint, that's an anterior bite plate, really. It's an old splint. If it has the same outcome as a flat plane splint, but it causes more occlusal changes, and it causes more, and it can be aspirated, that's the reason I wouldn't use it. I think that's why that now the NTI is trying to come out with a full arch, is to get around that issue. I will say one thing. The research suggests that there might be more occlusal changes with a soft splint if it's not adjusted. So the bottom line is it probably doesn't matter if you use a full coverage soft, intermediate thermoplastic, or hard, as long as you adjust the bite so that it's even. I have had a few anecdotal things of patients saying with a soft splint, it makes me chew on it like gum, but I think that they can do that on a hard splint too. So I think the principle is keep it reversible, cover all the teeth, and don't sweat the details. I always ask patients, what do you think? And they actually always, they met three answers. Hey, I can make this soft so that you have to heat it up, the thermoplastic ones, and it's a little softer on the teeth, and it's usually a little more comfortable on the teeth, but not always. I can make a hard one, or I can, I give them the option. And if they tell me, oh, that's soft, that makes sense. Hard makes sense because soft, I think I chew. Again, it takes a moment. Ask the patient what they believe. So, that answer your question?
Yeah. Röntgen discovered the radiograph in 1895, and that's probably what we used our first decade or two. Now it's all gone to 3D with the CBCT. Has your use of a 3D to be able to look in the disc, the joints, has that been a game changer in your oral facial pain TMD clinic?
No. The fact of the matter is I've done lots of studies. My last study, two studies ago, we took 725 subjects, and we did bilateral TMJ MRIs and CTs on them all. Okay? I've looked at x-rays and MRIs all my life. You know what the bottom line is? You know what for my study on developing diagnostic criteria, I had to have 100 normal patients. I had to have 100 patients with slip disc or disc displacement with reduction, 100 with on and on to arthritis. You know what the second hardest diagnosis to find is?
What?
Normal.
Right,
you know what?
Right.
We had 150 patients that two TMD experts at three universities, including our own, said were normal. Out of the 150, we were right when we looked at the MRIs and CTs on 100 of them. A third of them had a disc displacement. You got patients out there clicking. It's a high probability they have a disc displacement. But the silent ones, you got a 1 in 3 chance that any of your patients, probably over 18, a 1 in 3 chance that they got a displaced disc in one or both their joints. You just don't hear it, and they don't notice it. So, no, that didn't change it. Cone beam CT, that doesn't show the disc. It shows me the condyle. So it'll show me if I have arthritis, but it won't show me anything else. I mean, osteoarthritis. And so, and is it the position in there? Is that very good? It's really hard to make statements on position because when you have two radiologists read the same x-ray, they can't get that one right. I tried. And so the bottom line is, the cone beam CT came late to the scene from my perspective. If you want to see soft tissue, you got to use an MRI anyway. Certainly CT is superior to MRI looking at the hard tissue, but the hard tissue doesn't really give you a clue exactly on the diagnosis till you see the end stage. So the only reason I would tell the practitioner out there, one thing is if you do see significant degenerative changes on your cone beam CT in the TMJ, I would be a little concerned about doing a full mouth rehab or something, because as soon as you take the proprioceptive input out of the teeth, it can shift positions into odd things. And if it's going to go into odd positions, the most predictable odd position is an open bite with maybe a little retrusion. The other thing I'll tell you about the cone beam CT is you got all that information out there. No one's, and if you aren't reading all the cuts in the brain and everything else, there's still a question out there what the medical legal liability is if there's something on those films that you didn't see.
Yeah, well, that's something my malpractice should worry about. I don't worry about my house burning down either. That's what farmers should worry about. I don't worry about wrecking my car. That's what farmers should worry about. You know, you remember what the first x-ray was taken of when Röntgen took it, this first x-ray?
No, I don't.
It was his wife's, Bertha's hand. Remember, it's got that big old wedding ring on it?
Oh, any burger.
He was x-raying his wife's hand. Okay, you promised me you'd give me an hour of your deal. I know you're at the ADA convention. I'm already 3 minutes over. Thank you so much for time. Can I ask one more overtime question?
Sure.
Okay, so I'm going to throw you under a bridge on this one because you're not going to be able to make everyone happy on this. One of the specific questions they have and they post on Dental Town, you know, every student comes out of dental school and says, I didn't get enough experience on, you know, something, you know, more molar endo, or I didn't place one implant, or I Didn't do any veneers or Invisalign or whatever. And they have all these wish list things they want to learn. And when they're specifically learning in your area, TMD, the marketing is enormous. There's basically a decision they have to make. It's like neuromuscular or CR. So you have like the Pankey Institute, the Dawson Institute, COIS, SPEAR, yep. And that's kind of a CR deal. And then you got this massive other camp, neuromuscular, major players like LVI. What would you say to that kid? She's like, well, should I go down the neuromuscular route or should I go down the CR route? What would you say to her?
I would say that pain is not just a biological phenomenon. There is biological issues there that need to be addressed, but you have to really look at the whole person when you're treating this. If you want some education on this and you want to really dive into this, most of the programs in the – I mean, not most, but many of the programs in this country that have a TMD residency program, that includes Jeff Oakeson down in Kentucky. That includes me. I do a three-day mini residency where I have 8 dentists come in and 8 physical therapists, and we do 3 days of treatment, of training with them. We start with differential diagnosis. We then go through what a physical therapist can do. The psychologist comes in and lectures for an hour and a half how to help patients increase compliance and how to deal with the difficult patient or the patient that's not getting better. What to look for there, and then we go into clinic and they see us working on the patients, and then they work up a patient the last day, and then we also have other lectures. What I would say is many of the academic places that have residency programs, and that includes UCLA, there's a number of them. They all have programs, and some of them are extended. I know that Jeff has a certificate program where you come in over a period, I believe, of a year. It's not a massive amount of time, but if you really want to get an education in this, and you want to know not only about the biological, how to use splints, how to use medications, how to use self-care, how to maximize the patient's ability to heal themselves and to maximize their ability to self-manage, but if you want to look at other options within it, these are good places to consider.
Well, for your marketing, how often do you have that 3-day course with limited eight?
Well, I have it yearly, and right now I have to say we have a 2-year waiting list.
So why don't you make it bigger? Or have more of them or raise the price?
Well, I mean,
if you go to market and you say, I got this thing and it's sold out 2 years in advance, your price is too low. So think of it as a go-kart. You either got to hit the brakes and raise the price to give people who value it more the freedom to come in and buy it this year, or you got to hit the gas and have more courses or more students. You either got to increase capacity or price, but you can't sit there at the 2-year line out your front door.
Well, you know what? I've had that for about 20 years, that waiting list. And what I've done is I have increased it a couple times, but the CE area won't let me increase the price. I will tell you that.
Oh, it's at University of Minnesota?
Yeah. And so, politics and money are the flip of the same coin. And I used to think that there was a fair amount of politics in a university, but now I know it's only 99%. and so, yeah, there's an issue there. Oh, we don't want to charge money. Da, 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 da. And the other thing is, you heard my CV. You know what I'm doing. I'm running practices that I'm a co-owner in. I'm running huge research studies. I'm trying to help with the education of residents. I run undergrad courses. And frankly, everybody wants me to do more everywhere. And this is all I got.
Well, you know what I want you to do so bad is I want you to do some digital courses, because you can be asleep. I mean, you make it one time, or you can film your next lecture or what have you. But when you're sleeping, they'll be listening to it in Kathmandu. I'm so proud of the online CE, because the online CE and these podcasts are downloaded in every single country. So you're lecturing a dentist right now in China, Iran, Iraq, Tanzania, Namibia. I mean, just – and the U.S. dentists say, damn, dude, this is good stuff. Thanks a lot. But the people in Africa and Asia and Latin America, those emails are the most amazing, because they say things all the time like, it'd be 2 months' wages for me to fly to LA to listen to this course.
Yeah.
And you're giving me this course on my smartphone. We make them free. We only charge online CE in the 20 rich countries, but in all the 200 poor countries, they're free. And they're also podcasts are free. But I've had female dentists just literally start crying because they said, you know, when I was in Africa saying, you know, all my CE is from you for free. You know, I owe you so much. And so digitize this. You can work less and teach more. But hey, all I want to say is, man, I just love you to death. I think you're amazing. I feel sorry for you picking the crazy area of dentistry instead of something more predictable. Like oral surgery.
Why would I bother? Hey, I'll tell you one last thing. When I started all this, I was a philosophy major when I went into school. Okay. and then I got philosophical about my income. All right. And so then I went to dental school and I thought, you know, I was debating between medical and dental school. And I thought, I think I'll go to dental school. And I don't think I can kill people there. I was wrong, but I thought that. And it all turned out that in the end, I'm back in philosophy. And I love it.
Well, I love you. I love this lecture. Thank you so much for coming on my show.
Just some final points that I'd like to make. One is I'm doing a study right now with the National Institute of Health, and I'm the head of the study. And what the study is about is we need 200 dentists to recruit 2,000 patients. We wanted to recruit over a year period about 10, but there is no minimum. It can even be one. But we prefer 10, maximum of 20. What we're trying to do is get all the philosophies of care out there in this study. So we are looking for dentists, and it goes right into what you said, Howard, which is that there are a lot of different philosophies out there. And in the study, what the dentist has to do is they have to recruit some patients, and then they have to fill out a questionnaire on a tablet that we give them, and they will just answer what the patient's diagnosis was, what was the treatment, and identify what was the philosophy of care. And this is the best way we can get some evidence on how much do patients pain decrease, and how much does their ability to use their jaw to eat and do other things improve with treatment. And we're looking at whether they're acute or chronic and many other things. Do they have a lot of oral habits, etc.? But the dentist just has to tell us what they think the patient, what's going on with the patient, and what they're doing with their treatment. No matter what the treatment is, we want them to do it. So I want all these different philosophies of care out there to be represented in this study. Now, if they're interested in this study, I will provide the information to you, Howard, so that you can put it on, but they can actually email me at schif001@umn.edu, and I will get them connected with a coordinator in their area if they want to be in this study. They don't have to follow up the patient. We're going to pay for follow-up with the patient. We are going to send them questionnaires at 1, 3, and 6 months to see how they're doing and see if we have a good idea whether different types of treatments maybe have different outcomes. It's not as controlled as we would like. I'd like to have a randomized clinical trial where we assign patients to different treatments, but this is the first step, a nice observational study so we have an idea how are patients doing out there, as well as do they comply with treatment. And the most important thing, one of the most important things besides how the patient's doing is what is the treatment that is being done and why is that done? So we have a good idea on are these treatments working and are patients doing it. I want all the philosophies represented because I want to know what is our best treatment for our different kinds of patients. The second thing that I wanted to mention, Howard, was with my restful jaw device, we talked about it with a TMD patient. But actually, this device is useful for patients that have, for any patient where you're going to do a long procedure or you're going to put a lot of force on the lower jaw, like with an extraction. Also, if you use it with a bite block and the support under the jaw, the patient doesn't move, they're comfortable, and you can save about 30% time. It works really nice with the isolite system where that's holding them open, and this is keeping their jaw in one stable position so that they aren't moving and they're comfortable.
If they're comfortable, you're going to get a better result. And if they're comfortable, they're going to be happy and they'll look at other possible treatments. It's also good for Parkinson patients. If you put a bite block in with this, they stop movement for your special need patients and other patients like that.